Okay, so I will talk today about, about embodiment. What does it mean, embodiment? Everybody have a body, I hope. Still, we have a body. And the body have very big meaning for our perception. So we can say that our body is extension of our cognitive system, and I will talk from this perspective about interaction with technology. What does it mean to make technology for interaction with the body? Not only with our eyes, with our logic, with our abstractive way of thinking, but more with emotion, more with senses, and with social context. So this will be the topic. And my background is, of course, computer science, so I know how to make code. But then, after finishing computer science, I started PhD on psychology. So I have two perspectives, one human perspective, another technical perspective. And because of those two perspectives, I start to work in between. So my main topic was human-computer interaction, this area of research. But finally, I start to work with some artists, and now I also teach in design school. I establish new postgraduate program on creative coding. So I will talk something about this. What does it mean to make code which is creative? And what does it mean to make something creative at all? Okay, so let's begin. If we think about something like this, oh no, like this again, like this. Have you ever experienced the interaction with the clay? Anybody? Okay, somebody. So what is the first memory, if you think about it? What kind of feeling you have? Texture? Yeah. What, something more than texture? Temperature? Oh, senses, better. And some emotion, yeah? It's pleasant? Yeah, so this is emotion. So our senses are very connected to the emotion. So this is very emotional thing also. But if we look on the technological world, it's something different. It's clean, it's cool, cold, it's not so emotional. It's not exploring our ability of human hand, our skilled device which can manipulate our surroundings in a very sophisticated world. So let's look again. A lot of dirt, but emotions, but rich feelings, sensual feelings, and again, cold, flat screen, glass, cold glass. Sometimes I tell to my students, interaction with digital space is like kissing a girl through the glass window. We are on this level of interaction. So I think there is something we can do with this. If we look in our body and how our body works and what does it mean to have a body and to perceive our world with the body, we change the perspective and we start to think about technology and designing technology in different way. And code is a part of the story because with code we can do sophisticated system which react very similar way how we react as a human. So I talk about this much more today, but I hope that the future of the technology will be more like this. Of course, what is computer now, nobody knows. Of course, probably this is a computer. People use it a lot, but don't recognize the computer in this device, so they use this without any, you know, kind of barrier, like PC was a barrier for many people, digital barrier. Now the phone, everybody can use the phone, yeah? And I think in the future we will have less screens, more rich experience. And I have a honor to talk about this with Alan Kay. And I like this sentence of Alan Kay that the future is hard to predict. We can't predict the future, but we can invent the future. So I hope I will put some contribution to this invention to direct our attention in direction of the body, not again to the screen, to the logic, to the kind of abstract thinking. And technology is changing very, very rapidly. Every year we have smaller and smaller chips. For example, this Intel Kiri, Intel Kiri was introduced in 2015, and it's a size of the button. And the cost of this chip is like $3. It's very cheap. I think in two years it will cost like 25 cents maybe. And it's quite powerful. It's so powerful like Pentium 4. You know, Pentium 4 was enough powerful to have everything on the desk. Internet, office programs, everything. So we don't need much more power to do our daily jobs. But now we can have this power in a button. So what's the change this cause? This caused a change, dramatic change, because now people mostly use the technology to communicate with other people, to consume some media, some streaming, some video, audio. So this is communication and entertainment. But in the future, and now, it's happening now actually, it starts to be cognitive system. So now technology is not for communication, it's for cognition. If we think about Google car, it's kind of experiment for a big scale with embodied cognition, because the car is driving in the traffic and making everyday experimentation on other cars. And this car, in this way, can learn our environment the same way as we learn, because this car has a body and is physically embodied in our physical world. So it's first time in history that artificial intelligence is not cut out from the physical world. It's engaged in physical world with the body. So from the perspective of theory of artificial intelligence, it's a dramatic change which will accelerate very much the developing of artificial intelligence, and probably soon that this intelligence will be equal to the human intelligence. Of course, it will be not the same kind of intelligence, but can be adapted to our physical world the same way as we are. So it's really, really something. And for example, we can attach some vibromotors to the chair. And the chair have a body. And because of the vibromotors have also possibility of mobility to move around the environment. And this chair start to learn how to explore surroundings, yeah? Trying to vibrate one motor, okay, and then other motor, okay, and now, and start to learn how to approach the object, how to move around, how to communicate with people, how to help us maybe to, you know, to live in a more smart environment. It's embodied cognition. So computer power start to work as a cognition, not communication, not information processing in a way we think before. It's kind of cognitive system which can learn, adapt to the environment. It's really something new because this system have a body. And another thing is happening. Now using the hardware is so easy like before using the software. You don't need to build a factory to make a physical prototype type of device using some electronics. So there is a lot of prototyping platforms which can help you to make a device, physical device. So you can embed code in a physical device and make something which exists physically, and we can physically interact with this without screens. So this device can have a body and so on and so on. It's make a dramatic change. I call it blending bits and atoms. Like Hiroshi Ishii's idea, he has a team at MIT making this research, but it's really powerful thing. If you think about blending the barrier between physical world and digital world, so the item and the bits will work together. There will be no difference between bit and the atom. So this is the idea of Hiroshi Ishii of radical atoms. he started, of course, with researching of graphical user interfaces. Of course, graphical user interfaces, you can interact with them through the glass. This iceberg is kind of information you want to interact with. And the level of the ocean is the, you know, is the glass of the device. So in idea of tangible user interface, part of this information outside of the to the physical world. So you can manipulate with physical object to interact with some digital space. The first work of Hiroshi was kind of he designed for architects some kind of space for designing for arranging the building this way that one building not make shade for the other building. It's very hard task to move building around this way that you have sun all the time, every hour during the day, every year, and so on. It's a very hard task, but if you give architect the physical building, but shadows are projected from digital space, compute digitally, then you can explore this and achieve the result much, much quicker than doing the same on the screen. So he developed this kind of interfaces, and now he have this idea of radical atoms. So there will be no divide between physical and digital world. So if something is physical, can influence directly digital information, and if you influence this digital information, it appears as a physical thing. Of course, today it is not possible. To do it, you need, millions of nanobots which works together to make something. But Hiroshi have very nice approach to the research. He called this vision-driven design research. So if something is not possible today, okay, let's do it today. Good idea, yeah? Don't wait 20, 30 years for the technology. Let's do it today. And for example, he did this kind of table, which is exemplary of this radical atoms idea. So this table transform in real time, adapt to our needs, and it is kind of radical atoms examples. There are physical pixels which, and these physical pixels, yeah, change object physically. This is not a screen, this is physical object, which can manipulate other object, which can change a shape. And it is possible now. I work with this table. I touch it. It's real thing. It's not a fake post-production effect. It's real thing. It's working. And it's way to explore the idea of radical atoms today. It's not a nanobot, of course, but you can explore today what will be possible in 20 years. Explore the idea, the human needs in this approach. You design some artifacts to understand how people in the future can use these artifacts to train different scenarios of use of this kind of device. Yeah, it's something more to get physical manifestation of emoticon than having it only on the screen. It's much more emotional, of course. I like this student of Hiroshi Ishii. He is wearing this hat all the time. Yeah, and you have this physically. Yeah? So it looks like magic, but it's a real thing. And there are more and more things like this. This is another example of shape-changing materials. So to make this kind of object, you need new kind of materials. So this is a material which can change shape this way that this material is flexible. You can bend it, and then it starts to be stiff again. So you can shape any shape this way, and this shape starts to be fixed shape. For example, you can make chair or table very easily with this device, with this material. Bit long. Okay, let's wait. So it's very interesting. The computation is somehow embedded into the material. So you can have intelligent material in somehow. So material can have some extra properties which are not possible for the traditional materials. And of course, this material can also be an interface. It's feel pressure, so you can interact by pressing. Because you know how material is changing the shape, you can also make a texture in real time, which adapts to the shape. And this is my, I like this example most. Every designer wants to make a chair. So it will be kind of a chair. Voila, you have a chair. Okay, and another material. Okay, yeah. And another material, it's a 3D printed material, but you can print a hair. So it's something new. There are no hair printer on the market now, but there will be. There are prototypes of this. And this material have very big potential because you can change the density and the thickness of the hair, and this way you can introduce some behavior to the material. Material have a memory. You can design material this way that it's know how to behave in some circumstances. For example, you add vibration to the material and it's react to the vibration in a given way, which is designed. And so on, so on. So, of course, you can print everyday object like brushes and straps and so on. It's everything 3D printed. So somehow you can code the material. So you. Through the code, you introduce some properties inside the materials. It's encoded. The behavior of the object on the surface of the material is encoded. You add vibration and it's moved on the path you designed before, changing the properties of the material with the code. And I like this very much. Yeah. You add vibration and you change vibration to the rotation. Or to the vertical movement. And you can design very nice object this way. For example, some kind of object which inform you have a call by vibration. Vibration change to the rotation. New kind of the object. And I also try to explain this kind of thing with my students. I ask designers to explore aesthetic of interaction. It was for them very hard task because designers are taught how to solve a problem. So they ask me, okay, but what is the problem? No, you have to explore some idea, some properties like aesthetics. Okay, but what does it mean? What we have to solve? No, you have to explore. Explore what does it mean that interaction with the object is aesthetic. So you have aesthetic interaction. Okay, so next week we meet again and they ask, okay, but what is a problem? What we have to solve? So then we go through the phenomenology, through the philosophy of cognition, through some theories of psychological theories of embodiment, embodied cognition, and then after 2 weeks they understand, okay, so we have to explore this phenomena. So they start to design object in different way, object which are aesthetic, not in a form, not in a color, other properties of the object, but in aesthetic in which, in this what happened between you and the object. So this object somehow not looks beautiful, but also works beautifully. And first example of this kind of object was Magnetio. Magnetio is a kind of statue with some metal balls on the top. And these balls have very strong affordance. In terms of ecological psychology, Gibson theory of affordances, it's strong affordance. Everybody passing by this object wants to touch these balls. Everybody. No way. And if you touch these balls, you feel they are somehow hot and work like a clay. And you start clay these balls because they stick to each other. And you can't stop doing it because it's very pleasant, emotional, very sensitive. So you start to do it because it is pleasant. And then you feel if other people are passing, the strength of the magnetic field is bigger, so you can glue bigger things together. So you ask other people, let's do it together. So it changed the behavior of people around the object. And then people discover if they move away from the object, the shape disappears. And it is amazing then, because people start clapping, smiling, the expression of the emotion is just automatic. They can't stop this emotion. We do research, why they have this emotion? And they say, because it is. Yeah, it was great experience. So we clap and we are smiling. And then they ask each other, okay, it's pleasant, let's do it again. And now another psychological theory works. It's called a theory of chameleon, which tells that if you synchronize your action with other people, you start like each other. So we put this object during the conferences. One of them was in San Jose, California, during the Human-Computer Interaction Conference, very big conference. And we ask people, we do some research, everybody react this way. Even people from Google or from Facebook, they play with this object and they like it and smile like other people. So this theory works in practice. Yeah, exactly, yeah. They smile. Okay, sorry. Is anybody from Facebook or Google here? Yeah, from Apple too. And it works even more because we ask people which are shy and usually don't make many contacts during the conference, and they thank us because they was more open through this object and know more people because through this interaction they start opening for other people. And we have some investor from California. They ask, okay, you have commercialized this object because it can be put in a company on the corridor and people will not go to the cigarette place, but to this object and clay these balls together and talk about project and be more creative. We want this object. Let's commercialize it. So look, designers start to explore some phenomena like aesthetic of interaction. Have no purpose to solve a problem. Just explore some phenomena. And on the end, we have some practical things which this object can do. Yeah, why it's happened like this? Because it is part of embodied cognition theory. In embodied cognition theory, the meaning of is given by the user during the interaction. Designer don't know what will be the meaning. The meaning appear during the using the object. And this is another approach. Oh, we meet our guru, Hiroshi Ishii. He wants to make a photo with us with this object, so he was very happy, so yeah. And so again, let's summarize. So embodied interaction design is more connected with emotion, senses, and social context. This social context is very important for us. But if you design for screen, for some abstract thinking, you are more connected to logic, to language, and to abstract thinking. And our brain is not good in thinking. Probably you know, if you try to think about something, it's very hard, it's very tough to think, yeah? You have pressed your brain to think. It's not easy to think. Because our brain was not developed for thinking. It was developed for emotion, for pattern recognition, for being in social context, not for thinking, and especially for abstract thinking. It's not something natural for the brain. So if you have a problem, as every time I repeat to my student, if you have a problem with thinking, you have healthy brain. That's okay. Thinking is hard. And if you look on a theory of embodiment from more practical point of view, more artistic point of view, what happens with your body determines your cognition very much. So this artist makes his creation by moving his body with the robot. So he is a tool in the hand of the robot. KUKA robot is a very strong robot, used usually in factory. But because this robot is shaking his body, his mind is also perceiving this situation in different way. And this act of creation is very specific because of this. And even more. So if you look on this embodiment, you can say that how we perceive our world is determined by our body. If we have different body, we will have more eyes, more hands, or for example, we will be like, you know, smaller. Everything change our perspective, and it change our thinking. Some of theories even tell that we are human because we have a thumb, and the thumb is right size. If we have shorter thumb, we will stay the monkey, never have a brain like a human. So the body have really strong influence on our brain. And if you look on this experiment, in which you can say that the world is a tool in our hand, but in this experiment, we are the tool in the hand of the world. In this experiment, people have some exoskeleton on the top part of the body, and because of this exoskeleton, they start to dance like a professional dancer. They are volunteers. They don't know how to dance, and especially how to dance in performance, in synchronic dancing. It's very hard way of dancing. You have to perform like 3, 5, 6 years sometimes to make this perfection. But with these robots, they are perfect from the beginning. They are perfect dancers. And I asked them after this experiment, what they feel during the dancing like this. And it was amazing. They feel something what is called in the psychological theory out of body experience. They feel that they are out of the body and looking at this situation from the side. Because they lost control on the top part of the body, this situation changed the state of the mind, and they think they are outside of this situation because they have no control. Of course, before the experiment, they was asked, don't try to force it, to fight with this, because this exoskeleton have power like 60 kilos pressure. So you can't stop it. You have to move like it wants to be you to be moved. So yeah, there is no way to stop it. And they have this out-of-body experience. So what happened with our body change our mind very, very much. So again, the embodiment is the theory which referred to us as a living being, feeling, bodily entity. We are bodily, don't forget it. you can have some, you know, VR glasses on the head and you forget you have a body, but still we have a body. And we are embodied in our physical surrounding, and it's changed everything. It's in contrast with some theories, earlier theories from psychology and philosophy that we are some kind of human cognition is kind of abstract information processing. Sometimes we try to make some, you know, similarities between brain and computer. Computer is some kind of information processing system and the brain is some kind of information processing, but this is not true. The brain is not separated from the body. The brain is a part of the body and the body's extension is a part of our cognitive system, so we feel with the body. If you feel love, where you feel the love? In the brain? No, somewhere here. Yeah, or maybe in the stomach even. You have some kind of feeling in the stomach, not in the brain. So the body is very important part of our cognitive system, but if we design technology, we forget somehow about it. But we can do it different way. Even vending machine can be different. If you design vending machine using these embodied theories, you can design machine which react to our body. Choose me, master, choose me, master. Yeah, it's react with the body of the machine to the human passing by. And of course, with typical machine, you have some keyboard and you have put the number of the drink, yeah? It's abstract thinking, in logical thinking. Our brain is not designed for thinking. People don't like this kind of experience. And this is natural for us, yeah? We want this drink, okay, I want you. It shows the price. No, I don't want you. Maybe this. I like this, yeah? And on the end, he chooses the Coke, of course. Yeah, and so on. So it's important to do things this way. It changed everything. Even companies like Amazon, they start to make a vending machine on airport, for example. Why? Because people think that Amazon is some abstract, not existing thing. It's only in virtual space. But if you see the machine from Amazon on the airport, physical thing, oh, you see the Amazon is really existing. I can touch it. It's real thing. And it's changed attachment to the brand. It's very important to have physical things. And again, the speaker. But this is not a typical speaker. It's not a very high quality speaker, but this speaker can enjoy our music. And because of this, people want to have this speaker. Wow, it's amazing. Yeah, this speaker can enjoy our music. Bodily, not animation on the screen. He have a head and a leg. Yeah, it's a... And this man first finished the robotics and then finished the animation school at Disney to understand how to give a soul to the robot, to make robot more human. An attachment to the technology, if you make interactive technology, which is physical, like a robot or the toy or some physical object you can interact with, we can do very strong attachment to this kind of object, very emotional attachment. In Japan, the attachment to the robot Aido is so strong that people because these robots are not produced anymore. They stopped producing this robot in 2009. And these robots are breaking and not working anymore. So they die somehow. So the people need this kind of ceremony to pass this robot to another, you know. Yeah. It's a real thing. Really. It's funny for us, but for these people, it's really dramatic experience to, you know, to lose the robot. It's like a part of the family. It's family dog, not a robot. And this robot, of course, is very sophisticated in the way that every robot is unique. On the beginning, every robot is the same, but the robot learns from the owner some kind of behaviors. And after some time, every robot is different. There are no two similar robots. So have unique set of behaviors, unique character and so on. So you grow somehow this kind of robot. Yeah. It changes everything. Okay, you can have Tamagotchi on the screen, but nobody does this kind of ceremony from Tamagotchi. But for this kind of robot, people do it. And another thing you can have if you have a body, you can have something which is called morphological computing. So you can attach sensor to the body this way that you don't need a computer power to solve a problem. Just it's solved automatically through the body and sensor outside of the main processor. And you don't need so big power to compute things like this. You have only two sensors in this system, one at the front, another at the back. And you use one motor. If you touch sensor at the front, the motor put this thing to the front, and if you very slowly and stop it, and if you touch the sensor on the back, it's moved very fast. And people feel it like an animal. They say, oh, it is like a cat. It's like to be touched this way, yeah? And have a lot of feelings to this object, like to the real animal. And don't try to touch a cat from this side. Yeah? It's the same. It's very emotional. Only two sensors, one motor, and very emotional object. And again, Mr. Fabian Hamamet trying to make some more empathic phone. And he discovered that the phone have a body, not only the screen and some interface, have a body, and you have do something with the body of the phone. And this phone have a heart and is breathing very deeply if somebody important is calling us. It's breathing and the heart is beating faster. And after call, you have cooled down the phone because it's still breathing. Yeah, it was very important call. It was very important call. And you have calmed down this phone, yeah, after the call. So you are very empathic to this kind of phone. Yeah, it's not a typical phone. It's like a pet. Of course, we can also explore our feeling in a muscle, in the muscles, to do more sophisticated interfaces. This is a phone which has some weight inside, which moves, so center of the mass is changing. And you can feel the position of the object in the interface with your body by changing, you feel it in with your muscles, because you feel it's more heavy from this side, or it's more heavy from this side. So you can have two ways of perception it. One is visual perception, but other is bodily perception. You can feel with your body the position of the thing on the screen. And it changes also the perception very much. And of course, even these kind of companies try to adapt this idea. This taptic engine is something different than just vibrating motor. It's something which can gently tap you in your hand, and it changes a lot the way you perceive the interaction with this technology. So why they decide to put such a big device? This taptic engine take like a 1/4 of the space of inside the watch, but you know the problem of the watch is the battery. Bigger battery, better, because watch is working not half a day, but 2 days, yeah? But they spend so a lot space because this feeling is so important for us, more important than the battery. And of course, you can also change the way we interact with the screens. Screens are not bad if you look on the screen, not like on the screen, but like an object with the screen. And in this example, we have multiple objects. You can manipulate this object with your hand using our special abilities, yeah, our ability to move around in the space and to change position of the object around us. And if you interact this way with object, it's very engaging. And it can be, of course, for the play, but also for teaching. There are a lot of examples for this device to teach how to count, how to read. And it engages children very, very much, much more than application on the tablet. And again, I call it behavioral programming. So you program this robot by behavior. So if you want to move some part of the robot, just you are just moving this with your hand, and save this movement, and then repeat this movement later. And if you have a lot of parts which are moving, you can do something more which are moving. And if you give this to the kids, they don't feel a barrier of programming. Just program by moving. And then, of course, they ask, okay, but I want this to react to some circumstances. Okay, it's not possible to program it this way. And then children are open to more sophisticated way of programming with text, for example, yeah, more professional code. But they begin this way, and they are engaged much more, and they are brave to start programming. And this is also a nice example how to make programming, how to teach programming in different way. There are physical object, robot, and board, which are also physical. Yeah. Function. You can learn what is function this way, using the physical robot cubato. And really, child like this way of interaction with the code, much more than interaction through the screen. And it is also open source and open electronic project. You can download the code and the schematics, blueprints of everything, and design your version of Cubato, no problem. And again, I have nice talk with some creative director from Bank & Olsen, and he introduced me this TV set. This TV, you switch on this TV, and this TV is moving up, putting speakers down and to the sides, and it takes 7 seconds to switch on the TV. And engineers from this company don't want to produce this TV because nobody will buy TV which will run in 7 seconds. Who will wait 7 seconds? But people buy this TV, switch it on, wait 7 seconds, switch it off, and on again, and look of this movement, don't watch TV. They like this object. And it was really surprising for me. And my student comment on this, he have a car which have moving chair and moving wheel and some part of the some other parts are moving, and every time he get in the car he are excited about this 1,000 times again and every time he is excited. So the movement, physical movement, is really touching. And again, so Johann Storp decide to make a shop this way. He designed some kind of rotating walls. You sit on a couch, and this couch is rotating with you, showing you different TV sets. So this way, you don't need to move like a typical shop with electronics from the set to the set. This situation is moving you. You are rotating with whole scene to see different sets. And it was interesting because they first opened this shop in Peking, in China. And I have a story from Johannes, some rich Chinese enter the shop and show, I want this. So they ask, okay, which TV you want? Because there are many sets. No, I want everything. I want to have these rotating walls in my room. So it's really touching people. But the same in New York. They opened the store with speakers, but there are only one wall without speakers. There is no a lot of speakers like in typical shop. You choose the speakers you want to test, and then wall is rotating, and you see this speaker. And one rich lady from Manhattan wants to buy something for the husband for birthday, and when she look on the wall, and this wall was rotating, she called the husband, you have to quit your work and now go to this shop, see this, because this is magic. Go here, look it. So, yeah, it's also touched people in New York. not only in China. And another possibility, if you have technology which is embodied, you can do technology which is persuasive. You can change behavior. For example, in this case, if you want to take a car, you have to think about bicycle. No way, because if you take a car, the key for the bicycle is falling down. And yeah, so this device, you can buy it on Kickstarter. This device reminds you, you have a bike, it's conscious decision or some kind of habit, bad habit. Yeah, and it can change your bad habit to good habit. And again, I do some task with my student from fashion department, and they want to make some cloth for the table, so they make interactive cloth. And this is a modular, you can do it for whole family, and every plate has some light under, but this light appears when you put the phone in the pocket. When you put the phone in the pocket, the light appears, and your place is ready to put a plate. So everybody do it, but there is Faraday box in a pocket, so phone doesn't work after putting in a pocket. So after this, everybody can meal together without the phone, and we can discover we have a family. And nobody try to get a phone because there are some social tension. There is no one who wants to first switch off his light. So everybody keep phones inside. And other my students try to do something with musical sequencers. So he was fascinated by wood. So he made a wooden sequencer, some kind of music instrument, but made of wood. She used some Arduino platform, which is popular platform for making prototypes. And for this instrument, he got a grant from our Arduino Foundation. So now he's working as a designer in Arduino. His graduation work was a music. It was another musical instrument, which explore physical space. This way, it measure distance to the object around the musical instrument and play the sounds depending on the distance. And the system consists of many parts like this. There are many parts playing together, many instruments like this. You can put this instrument around your space. But what he discovered, what was very interesting to me, he discovered if you have mess in your room, the sound is more beautiful. So don't clean your room. Mess sounds more beautiful. And even if you have very, very typical game, everybody know the game, Angry Birds. But if you change the way you play, making really physical object, not, you know, making this on the screen, but you have real object, you change the game experience very, very much. And I have some extreme example of embodiment from Eindhoven. From Eindhoven. Some students from Eindhoven, as a final work, did something like this. It's a MP3 player, but you know, you interact with this player with your tongue. Yeah, I hope this is personal device. But look, because it is interaction with the body, special part of the body, it's make really emotional contact, yeah? Because it looks disgusting. Even if you don't touch it, you see only the movie and you feel it disgusting, yeah? It's really extreme example. But you can do something which is more, it's called speculative design. You use design to start discussion about something. In this case, it is discussion about safety of our data. So this girl have a phone as with special application. If some data is going away without the knowledge of the owner of the phone, some parts of this dress are opening at the same time. If more if more information is going away, these ladies start to be more naked at the same time. So when she walked out to the New York streets, she was naked at the moment. So it was a project from some school in New York, Tisch School. They have a program about interactive communication. Okay, I have to show it. It is another graduation work with this school called the Penis Wall. Yeah, so one student from this school liked this object very much, so wants to make some interactive installation from this object. Explore properties of this object before, of course, to understand how it moves, and then make it. And this is not funny. This is visualization of information, physical visualization of information, visualization of stock exchange on New York stock market. Really. Look, if some action going up, it's going up. If going down, it's going down. So you can visualize action on the stock market this way. Why? Because you can. Yeah. Of course, this object have two modes. One is for visualization of stock exchange, other for interaction. So you can interact with pennies by waving your hands. And this way you can interact, changing the... Yeah, this is the author of the work, interacting with the work. Okay, so it's also possible, yeah? I have an honor to work with some art director Garbaczewski on some theatrical act called Sexual Life of Savages. And we make some big installation, like 11 by 20 meters. It was interactive scenography. And actors act with this scenography. It was interactive, so it was one of the actors during the play. And it was, for me, amazing experience because working in a theater is different kind of work, really. But what is interesting in this case, director of this act asked us to cut some interaction because actors interact more with the island, with this interactive scenography than with each other and don't listen to the art director. So we have, you know, limit interactions. But on the end, it was interesting because he got very, very honored award in Poland called Paszport Polityki. And on the end, this became a modern art object shown in Modern Art Museum in Warsaw. And through this object, children start exhibition and learn what is a modern art. Another thing, this is a box we made for opening of National Forum of Music in Wrocław. It was a kind of box 3 by 3 by 3 meters. And we want people to approach this box because this box advertise some composition which win the contest for opening. So we put this box 1 week before the opening. And how to attract these people to the box? So we use some part of the music which start like om, like meditation. So this box make an om, this cube make an om, and then make some lights and lights go down. So people were interested, what's happened? Some cube is meditating in the middle of the square. So they approach and move around and discover some sound pieces. So I have, it was funny, I have two pluses among the Tibetan monks, because once I put a meditating box in the middle of the square, and the other plus, people go around this box. So it's very important for this religion. But one lady do even more. They approach the box, do like this, and it was scary for me. Too many religion in one box. Finally, I discovered he has a small camera and wants to make a photo inside the box through the some small part of the box on the bottom. Another is a displacement. That is a project I did with Krzysztof Goliński. It's a some kind of object which have to mix poetry, nature, space, and technology. So we design custom design devices, which consist of 140 screens. These screens you can put these screens around in the woods in the wild circumstances, and we ask some poet to make a poem for this device. So we make a device for the poet to do dynamic poetry in a space in natural environment. So this was a purpose of this work. And another thing was interactive wood. It was a part of exhibition in Brussels in the Art Gallery Bazaar. We made interactive wood which helped explore the stories, shadow narratives, bottom narratives, not mainstream narratives. And you explore these stories by moving a figure around the model of the bazaar. And there was half an hour of movies, but people explore everything. Spent half an hour because it was kind of point and click and it engaged so much. And they also don't understand how it works. How it is possible that wood is interactive? I answer usually it's magic. Yeah? It's, if you design technology well enough, it's not distinguished from magic. So it's another thing. It's a project which started as a scientific project. We, under the supervision of Professor Novak, we researched the four artists and curator during the 1 month of producing some piece of art. So we want to understand the pattern of interaction which appeared during this process. And I analyzed this interaction using some network analysis. So I have some pattern of interaction on the graphs of networks. But artists decide, oh, this interaction, these patterns are so interesting, let's make these patterns, this scientific artifact, the part of modern art exhibition. So I decide to make this physical object. I call it physical visualization of the living social network. And this way I start the new new etape in my career. I want to make the devices and objects which are kind of, it's try to explain some hard scientific theories in a more engaging way. And this is very, very important for me object. It is done by a group called Pan Generator. There are two students of mine and two co-workers in this group. And they made this object. It was done for Museum of Warsaw Uprise. And it was done for the universally for the but look, it's numbers about some fact from second world war, but this fact are visualized with this shell from the gun, and it have so strong emotional context. People get it very emotional. Every time I look on this, I have some, my hair is going up, and I feel it's really emotional. So if you do physical object, you can use these properties to move emotion to. And it's very connected to embodied theory. And again, this is 1,088 ceramic puppies, which represent fallen soldiers during the First World War. And if you go around this office, you can feel with your body what does it mean 188,000 people. Because this is so abstract number, you can't imagine it. But if you engage with your body into this information, you can feel it. So our body is very important in perceiving our surrounding, in perceiving information. So there is new area of research called data embodiment. So you can show the data on the screen, but if you show the same data using, for example, some rice, it's much more emotional and people can understand better relation between the data. Okay, we have not much time, so I will... Oh, this is, for example, sculpture, which shows different different type of violence in Detroit, but it shows also that this violence from year to year is lower and lower. But it shows through the sculpture in public space. Oh, yeah. So again, embodied cognition, I want to underscore it again, that what happened with our body change our mind. And if we have, for example, some attachment to our hand, kind of, yeah, double hand, we can do things we can't do now. And our brain is very plastic. It adapts quickly to new possibilities. On the beginning, I tried. On the beginning, it's very hard to manipulate this second hand. But after some time, brain switch off, and you feel this other hand like your hand, and you can use it. And then something strange happened, because after long time of using this extra hand, if you disattach this hand from your hand, you feel like amputation, because it starts to be part of your body. It's so strong. So it will be the time that we will attach some devices to our body, and it will change us forever. And of course, again, environment is a part of our cognitive system. And if you use this approach in designing, you can design something which engage people in interaction. It's again work of Pan Generator. It's an artistic platform which is not finished. The people decide how this will work on the end. So people are putting this object around and using the light, they engage this object into interaction, and some amazing pattern appears depending how people move this object around and how they switch and where they switch the light. So people start to be a part of the installation with the body and with our ability to move object around and to engage into the physical world with the object. And it's appeared to be an amazing installation. It was shown at the Copernicus Museum of Science during the festival called Power to the People. But then it was also shown during Ars Electronica, the biggest electronic art festival in the world. And this is again work of Pan Generator. It is in Poland, Museum of Polish Jews. And it is kind of a storyteller. You grab some history of family from the shelf, put on this device, but you do it physically. It's wooden, you can feel the fact, you can feel the fact texture. You put this on the machine, and then you interact with the story by moving the wheel of the history. And this history surrounds you. You become the part of the history, and also people around are attracted by the history because it is kind of, you know, something which is presented not only for you, but also for people around you. So again, social context, physical interaction, embodiment. And also embodiment in interaction with music, kind of embodied instrument, which express music by the movement. And at the same time, it's kind of chorus which can perform with you the music. So every speaker moves up and down depending on the loudness, and left and right depending on the frequency. And there is a little shift between the speaker, some latency, and it is enough to make some complex behavior, and people like it very much. They perform. It's very engaging. So embodied expression of the music. You can do the same with your flowers. Some plants at your house give new life to the plants by levitation. So plant is not at the same position all the time. It's rotating, so it's growing different way than typical plant. And it gives you new emotional contact with the plant. Okay, and now the most lovely part for me, the art of code. Yeah, the code and art is very connected, and you can use code to make creative application of technology. And for example, Atlas.com is a company who is doing this for many years, using the code and physical representation, for example, balls, which moves up and down, changing the shape of the surface with the music and light at the same time. It's kind of poetry, dynamic poetry of light and movement. And they explore other shapes also. So through code, through object, through light and through music, they make very unique experience for human. Or this amazing lamp, which move up and down, and it's contracted this way that have some air pockets which open, like in parachute. But this opening is not predictable at all. Depends on the speed of movement, and every time is different. And because of the light inside, you have some shades of light, and it's so. Biological structure, like some living form. So again, you can experience this like a wave of water at the seashore, and you can look and look, it's never be boring. Or you can do something with technology like this. It's a kind of jewelry, but which express some physical properties of your body. In this case, your voice. Every voice is unique. Every voice is very connected to the body. It's very special. The voice is like a fingerprint. There are no two identical voice. So you can record your voice, and then using the laser cutter, you cut the wheels depending on the loudness in every second of recording. And then you make a part of jewelry from this. We did this experiment with students. The hardest part is to move it from the machine in the right direction, in right order. And on the end, you have very, very personal piece of jewelry. It can be your voice or your neck. Again, machine which making a story of the river. There are some stone from the river, and this machine have some algorithm which can distinguish between patterns on the stones, and these patterns depends on geological period when this stone was washed away, and this way it's tell a story of the river, geological story of the river. So automata making a story of the river, and on the end some pattern appears which are similar to the pattern made by people living on the bank of this river. Some ethnographic research showing that these patterns are very similar. Oh, this is known example. This is kind of rain, but if you go into the rain, this rain switch off above your head, so you go through the rain, no wet at all. It's a strange experience. It is, again, example of creative coding with Intel. It's interactive mask. So there's big computer power behind because it's real-time face tracking. And depending on the expression of the face, the mask is changing. But this I like most. What's this? It's a mirror. Mirror make of fur. It's an example of creative use of technology through the code and electronic and some digital fabrication. You can make a mirror from anything. In this case, from black and white fur. And look how it works. It's a mirror. This artist is making mirror from everything, from wood, from fur, from any kind of material. Also, this engine are making some kind of noise behind, so it's nice. Oh, this is my lovely artist, Nicholas Roy from Berlin. He called himself, he's designer of not needed things. I like this. And I have talked with some chief of Intel, and I showed to him this movie, and I explained he's a designer of not needed things, really creative person. So this chief of Intel decided, okay, I will do this position in my company, somebody who will be designer of not needed things. Maybe he will design something really amazing. So I like to treat the technology not too serious, to make it, you know, to make fun from it. It's very important to make fun from it. Of course, there are a lot of business example of this approach. For example, for the brand, you can make something. Oh, this is the work of my students. For the brand Vox, some furniture company, we make this Wally, which attract people to old collection of furniture during the show of new collection. And it was funny because it was project of the psychology students, just some fast project, and people return after 3 months to this gallery asking, when can we buy the Wally? We want to have a Wally at home. And the owner of the company asked us to mass produce the Wally from this student. Yeah, work. So it was fun experience. And this is some advertisement for the brand about safety. So this was in Lisbon. They make a dancing red light to show people the problem that they pass on the red light. So how to persuade not pass on the red light? So do something funny about it. Not put a policeman, but do something funny about it. And at the same time, is advertisement of the smart brand. And another example, again, pan generator. Guy who is a manager of Mickey Mouse for the Middle East Europe asked them to make something with Mickey Mouse in a style of the group pan generator. So they make the, some kind of kinetic sculpture which listen to the sounds around, move the head of the Mickey Mouse to the direction of the sound, and then mix this sound and make a melody from these sounds and visualize this melody. So this kind of abstract object, which is part of, which is kind of installation, at the same time, yeah, Mickey Mouse, modern Mickey Mouse. And the same happened in the architecture. It's also connected with the code. It's a flocking algorithm which simulates the movement of the flock of birds. And if the flock of birds is moving through this object, they mimic the movements of the flock. So it makes nice experience. If you it changed the experience of this, of the building. And at the same time, it's a message that in this company, we work as a flock. We work together in synchronous way. We work well. But also, it's hypnotic experience. You can look and look on the sculpture, and it's never be boring. And again, the installation of mirrors, rotating mirrors. And some, from time to time, reflection from mirrors became a text. The name of the restaurant. Yeah. It's very sophisticated to do it this way. The same they do for Shanghai Expo, World Expo in Shanghai. Some message using the, you know, just glass and glass reflection, the very, very old way of communication. But if you connect this with technology, you can do some amazing things. This is example of this boss, but in connection with the brand. So you do some artistic exploration, and then you can also use it in a, some business environment. In this case, for the one moment, this boss make a shape of new car, new model of BMW. But you can do something for the people to show the brand in more engaging way, more funny way. No typical advertisement, in this case, McDonald's company. This was really not typical. They make a special bus stop, which was a music instrument, and people can experience 24 hours this instrument on the Krakowskie Przedmieście in Warsaw. So they record real reaction of real people to this instrument, and it became the advertisement of the brand as a viral movie in social media on the end. But it was real experience of real people in real situation. Not actors, not something fake. So you can also use the embodiment approach, making physical interactive object to making fun for people and at the same time something funny for the brand. Yeah, you can win, of course, some extra coupon for McDonald's playing the right sound. Okay, so my message on the end, let's detach eyes from the screen. remember, you still have a body, so think about the body. And think about the creative way of coding. So you can code for creativity, not only for some, you know, utilitarian purposes. So be creative with code, make it for fun, not only for work. It can be really, really enjoying making the code this way. Thank you very much.